city you look at, if it's not Catholic or whatever is profession, no profession, still has that imprint of the original Catholic ideal of an education. It has changed quite a bit, but you can still see, you can see starkly the differences, and you can see starkly the unities of what we still try to achieve. The fact that many faculties still struggle with what does it mean to be an educated person? What do people need to know in common? And even when they disagree and they can't come to an agreement, the struggle is there still to try to do it. I think that is a reflection of this origin of the university system in the Catholic in the Catholic Middle Ages, the imprint of that. But I would go even further and explode all categories. Already you can see that the way we're talking about education presupposes that it happens only in one place, in a school, whether it be a high school, grade school, or college. It happens everywhere. I'm a big fan of Mark Twain. His famous quip, of course, you remember, "I never let school get in the way of my education." That's typical of Mark Twain. But there was, I think, a vision in America that was quite unique. Our common school system, what we now call public school system, was an invention of the early to mid-19th century. And one of the great Catholic commentators at that point, someone who had converted from Unitarianism, Augustine Bronson, was real worried about common schools and the fact that one had to be required to go there. Because he thought of American democracy in itself as an educative force, that as people had to come to terms with decisions that were high-stakes decisions, what to do with property, how to live one's life, how to make laws, how to divide land, all the things that matter to us day in and day out, that people had the resources to do that, to learn that as they were doing it, that they didn't need to go somewhere especially to learn that. And you might say, well, that was a time of innocence. There wasn't as much knowledge in the world. Maybe. But it's a debate that continues. How can a society teach? Because if you don't recognize that societies and cultures teach outside of school, then you're ignoring where perhaps half at least, if not more, of the education happens. We all hold dear to our hearts the fact that education is a positive good. We love it. Nobody's against education. But it's so difficult when you don't have the cultural resonance and support to make it happen. So you have to look outside. What education goes on outside? It goes back to my point is that, yes, schools are the defined place for this to happen, but it's certainly not the full meaning of education.
Before you pass the mic, again, I have a question for you. Being that the Vice President of Academic Affairs for fairly large university, 3,700 students, very diverse university, it's a pretty daunting task to be, a leader of the university, such as the University of St. Thomas. So where do you begin in facing this task? What is your starting point in dealing or facing each individual, each faculty, each student, so that you're not overwhelmed with your work?
I begin with the people who know best, and that's my faculty, because they're doing it. I myself still keep a hand in teaching, because I need to feel that connection. But it always begins with a dialogue with the people who do this day in and day out. That's because we're not doing that. And universities can be tempted to all sorts of different things today. There are lots of things universities do today that were unheard of, maybe 30, 40 years ago. But our principal ideal is to educate the next generation. Tradition meaning the hand-on value of knowledge. So I always begin at that point. No matter how exciting, and believe me, there are a lot of exciting schemes we can get really creative with possibilities, but it has to begin there. What is going to be most effective for the students to get hold of the value of knowledge and to become better human beings, educating, to go back to what we've always thought of, the whole, you know, mind, soul, heart, emotions. I know all of them, but that's what I begin, where it counts.
Mr. Kaiser, same question. You have a school that has grown significantly with your leadership. I mean, we were talking about 164 students to 650. Again, it's a great accomplishment, but how do you continue that? How do you face your day-to-day challenges at St. Joseph High
School? Yeah. Does anybody in here work in high school or middle school? How many have gone to high school or middle school? It is... my job is very dramatic, okay? To say the least. Okay? When I got off the phone, when I got off the plane today, I had a message from the bishop, about an issue that we were talking about. When I got on the plane, I had an email from the family who said that they are not going to contribute anymore because their neighbor didn't get accepted to the school last week. Right? So that's just a sample of things, all right? I told them, you know, what they could do with their money. But listen, for me, my starting point is my own education. Okay, this is what I would say to you. Right? What I mean by this is that what I've learned is that I have to take seriously my own desire to be happy. And that's where my work as a Catholic educator, as a principal, begins. And the way that works for me is, and how I do that, is I spend the first 45 minutes to an hour of my day in silence. And I usually do this with classical music, usually with the Book of Hours. And I listen. I mean, I really just listen to what I want. And by that, I don't mean that in a superficial way. I mean that in the deepest sense of the longings that I have. Right? I'm an Augustinian in this sense that this heart wakes up every morning restless until it rests in God. And so that's how I begin my day. Now, why do I do that? Well, one, because I want to remain sane. Okay, that's one reason I do that. But another reason I do it is because I want to go into school with all that longing and all that desire in front of me so that I can recognize that in my teachers, in my students, in the parents that come through the door. Thomas Merton once said, and I haven't read a lot of Thomas Merton, I heard Father Barron say this and I like it, but that you know, when one time he was on the street corner in Louisville, and he saw everyone passing by, and he realized that he was united in desire with every single person. Right? That's the way I want to be in front of my students. And so I think that that starts with taking my own need seriously. Second thing I do, and this is a real stretch for a school administrator who's using plans and programs. I get paid for meeting certain goals and objectives and strategic plan objectives. But what I try to do is I try to pay attention to what's in front of me during the day. And I never do during the day what I set out to do during the day. Right? It's a perfect job for somebody like me with ADHD. But it requires, so if you're in front of reality with your heart open and things are happening around you, there's room for Christ to be present in that situation, to ask him to be present in that situation in front of my students, in front of my parents. I have a chair in my office that I affectionately call the crying chair. And there's a picture of John Bosco above it, a painting of John Bosco above it, because that's where people come into my office and cry. And what are they crying for? Well, I know what they're crying for. All right? There might be a lot of particular things that we're paying attention to, But what they're crying for is life, and life lived in a much more intense and full way. And so, if I'm not paying attention to what I need, I'm going to look at the people in that crying chair as a problem to get out of my office. Okay? And frankly, I've done it. I've done it a lot. And those aren't the good days. Those are the bad days. So
on that, what would you, in your opinion, what were the most urgent goals for a student?
Okay, so for me, all right, for my kids, like I said, we live in the buckle of the Bible Belt. My kids are wonderful. Okay? They mostly come from wonderful families, okay? Where mom and dad love them, and where there has been drama in their lives, so maybe there's a divorce or situation. Even those kids are cared for and loved, and they know it. They are polite, they're nice, they're generous, and many of them are pious. Okay, so job done, right? And so, but not only that, they're smart and they're on a path to success. Okay? They're very successful. You know, our kids go all over the country to school, and it's. So what I see the most urgent need, the most urgent goal for them is that they would pay attention to their humanity. Okay? That they would go to the depths of their human need. What I want them to know is how truly big their inbuilt desire is. In their freshman year, we teach them that they have an infinite desire and a limited ability to meet those needs. So we have this desire for truth, for beauty, for goodness, for justice that just churns inside of us. We live expecting these things in our lives. And so an example of that, it's the reason why I have probably 5,000 classical music CDs, right? Because I get one and I listen to it and I love it, and you know what? I gotta get another one because it's not enough, right? And you know what? It's not enough to have CDs. I've gotta get vinyl because they sound better on vinyl, right? My wife thinks I'm crazy, okay? And I am a little bit with respect to this, but for me, it's a sign of this, and the kids have the same need. Our kids are going to be successful. They're going to be successful. Their parents are successful, right? And it's interesting. Whenever I talk to their parents about this, you can see the looks on their faces. They're successful, but they're not fulfilled, right? Because it's not enough. And they and their children see it. I think we're educating the parents at our school maybe even better than we're educating the kids, because the parents have had an experience of reaching for things and getting them. These aren't people who don't have, but getting them and realizing that, okay, I got it, but I'm not happy I'm supposed to be. There's got to be something. So I'm like a broken record with this infinite desire, limited ability thing. Yeah, record, right? There we go again. I repeat it over and over again. I had a girl walk down the hall. I had to stop teaching at the end of the first semester. I was just too busy with other things. And she said, "We miss your infinite desire, limited ability speeches every day in class." Because I want them to get this. Why? Because if we don't understand this, when they meet Christ, they'll just say, okay. Nice guy, lived a long time. I'm glad he suffered for me, but it's kind of abstract, right? But if you realize you've got this infinite desire, and you meet the one who is God, you grab on to him and say, "Finally, I've had an experience." And I think they have that experience in my school community. So in a lived, present reality, these kids are happy. And they don't really know why they're happy. I know why. surrounded by a Christian community, and they're living life in a truly wonderful way. So, you know, that's a long answer to that question, but I would, just to summarize, the most urgent need is for them to pay attention to new demand.
Dr. AQUILA, same question. Anything that, from the University of St. Thomas, anything that you think a student at the University of St. Thomas, one of the urgent goals for a student?
I'm going to keep my answer short because I'm really interested in hearing audience questions and comments. So one of my favorite management theorists is Edward Deming. And what impressed me about his work is, first of all, he's the father of the Japanese management miracle, great musician, composer. And he had this proposition, it was a maxim. Banish fear from the workplace. Now, if you transfer that to schools, I think today it's appropriate for students. What I would say as a student goal is banish fear. Because to tie it back to what we've been discussing about the need for a critical intelligence, underscoring that criticism is not trashing something, but to take it apart, students come to us and they've done very well. They have usually performed well on tests so they can get into the schools they want to get into. But we have to, in a way, here at the college level, undo that understanding of education, which means taking a risk, because they're very comfortable in that. You tell me what you want me to tell you, and I'll tell you. That's the theory of their education. You mean, is that going to be on the test? Or, you know, all the cliches. But to be able to have students take a risk, to say, well, yes, the critical mind, you know, let's test this. Let's be vulnerable in what our knowledge is. And then gradually, as students mature into a kind of critical intelligence, and never, by the way, demeaning what went on before. That was important, served the purpose. But maturity in intellect and being human is to have this kind of critical mind, such that by the time they graduate, what students are ready to do is recognize, guess what? I can never know it all. Now, for many people, that's intimidating. For me, it's very liberating, because that means the pursuit of knowledge is going to be forever. You can never know it all. And you're always going to take intellectual risks. So we have to just create a culture which respects that. I'm not talking about silly, thoughtless risks, but prudential risks, even intellectual prudential risks. But that's my goal for when they graduate, is that they respect that knowledge is forever, that they're always going to learn, and that knowledge is not just the heaping up of facts that you know, put in your head, but how to think about them. I love this kind of gaze on them in a way that makes sense at the end of the day.
Thank you. And then, just for the sake of time, I'm going to limit myself to one last question to Mr. KISER. When we talk, are you as a Catholic educator, are you concerned at all about the dominant mentality, the dominant culture, and the effect that can have on the maturity of the faith?
Yeah, but I would say first I'm concerned about the effect that the dominant culture has inside of me. And I think, the dominant mentality is something that I think it worms its way in. I mean, we can try to keep it out, but it finds its way underneath the door. And we breathe its air in and out every day, students, parents, teachers, and right? So, and I would say, I've already alluded to this, but the central way it manifests itself in our schools, this mentality of success. I don't know if you've seen the documentary that's out right now. Came out in 2011. It's out on DVD, called The Race to Nowhere. Anybody seen that? It's about kind of the high-stakes education in high schools that take education seriously. And it's an hour of interviews with students and teachers about the this, about how they feel. They're stressed, they're overworked, they are filled with fear, because it all depends upon, the college depends upon their grades. And they're, if they don't get into the right college, they're not going to get the right job, and their parents are stressed out about this. And so, as one young man describes it, and they took the title from it, it feels like a race to nowhere. And I would say to you that at St. Joe's in Greenville, South Carolina, a lot of the time, it feels like this. That kids are primarily concerned about their GPAs and their SATs and their ACTs, and they get very involved with all the extracurricular activities because they think they have to have them to get into the school. And something pretty big is missed here. the whole purpose that we're doing this. Right? So I would say to you that a Catholic school should not be a race to nowhere. Now try to, and I think this starts with the teachers in the classroom, because that chauvinism happens in high school too, where the teacher thinks his class is the most important class and is not afraid to give a lot of homework, and they can do my homework and not the other guys if they're running out of time. So I think this is part of my task, is to try to get moving people in this direction. So I would say a Catholic school should not be a race to nowhere. A Catholic school, the proposal should be a pilgrimage to fulfillment, right? A pilgrimage to, the pace should be more the pace of a meditative pilgrimage. And it's one where we are going somewhere, and that is our happiness. So more could be said on that, but that's enough for now. So we can get to the other questions.
Thank you. We want to turn it over now to the audience for any questions.
Say homeschooling, but we homeschool our kids up until they come to St. Joe's. It is much more a pilgrimage than the Catholic school, and I think this is, we see the contrast, and so I'm faced with this struggle of how do I lead a Catholic school to slow down and to look more deeply at things. How do I move teachers who are very, very good in their fields, they're experts, I'm not, to be okay with not having exhaustive knowledge, or to be okay if not every single person gets a 5 on the AP U.S. History test, which is what this teacher has had for the last few years, but the kids kill themselves to get there. So. This is a very serious question for us in our school, and we have a faculty committee that's looking at it right now. How do we slow it down so that it becomes more of a pilgrimage?
Hi, I remember reading a book a while back. I think it was called Now Find Your Strengths or something like that, and basically the purpose of the book was that the way that we're brought up as students now is to focus on our weaknesses, or like we have to fix ourselves. You know, like if you're not good at math, then you have to spend all your time trying to be better at math, you know, even though you're better at English or other subjects, which is fine until you get to like high school or university level, where all of a sudden you're forced to you know, focus on what it is that you really are better at or talented at or successful at. So would you agree that this is a problem like in our education now? And what can we do to kind of solve this problem of focusing on students' weaknesses rather than strengths? Because perhaps this also lends like skepticism or the apathy that we find in a lot of students, especially as they get to like our age.
The strengths movement, my colleague Dr. Bobby Church will remember, I asked all my deans to take what's called the strengths finder, because we wanted to identify what everyone's strength was and shift the spotlight away from where our weaknesses are, but what are our strengths, and take an inventory of that. And I'm very favorable to that view. It comes out of the psychology of positive psychology of Martin Seligman. It's manifested also in this movement of appreciative inquiry, where it shifts the focus onto what can we do well, what are our strengths, and how can we use that to advance our humanity, in effect. And what it does is, and it's not the same meaning of critical that Holly was talking about. The criticalness that can be devouring is a negativism. It's kind of always dwelling on a weakness. We know our weaknesses, but we don't often celebrate the strengths, and strengths is a way to succeed. I am not far along enough in that movement to figure out how, when you're focusing on your strengths, how do you shore up places where you still need to be shored up. You can't ignore them. But I think it is, it provides you with a certain confidence that if you can have high achievement in some areas, that which seemed more daunting in another, you have the confidence to take it on.
This is a problem in my school. And it's the kids that do best in my school are the brainiacs, the ones that are good at everything. Okay? They throw themselves into the AP classes. They're recognized by the teachers. And then we've got a group at the bottom, I don't like talking about them this way, but who need some special attention. They're college-bound students. It's the BC student that is the problem in, I would guess, a lot of Catholic high schools. Because they're the kids that are forgotten, and they just kind of float. They float along with the rest of the group. They sometimes have the biggest desire. They're the kids that are aware, maybe more aware of their biggest desire, and it's their limitations that has helped them grow in that awareness. And so I think one of the things that we're talking about doing is tailoring the 11th and 12th grade years to strengths of their choosing. So we're probably, I shouldn't say probably, this is a discussion, but I would like to be at a point where we could go down four or five different paths. So a kid could follow technology, another one could follow science and medical, another one might follow math and engineering. And actually give them an experience of these things, I think we would motivate them much, much better. So,
Hi, my name is Dominic, AQUILA. my question has to do with, you mentioned democracy and the importance of education, democracy, and we hear it a lot. Certainly on the news, being educated voters, et cetera, et cetera. But I guess like the democracy is based so much on the education of the citizen in common form. But democracy also kind of inherently gives rise to a wide spectrum of theories and ideas about truth, about tradition, about education, about how things that ought to be done, and especially. The common attitude that we see a lot today of pursuing what it is that we want rather than an objective truth. how does the Catholic vision of education fit into all that, and how can it perhaps reshape the culture towards a vision of truth, and how do we practically impart a tradition when there is often so much criticism of stating something as true or holding a particular tradition when we are expected to be almost in a reactionary kind of way tolerant to everything around us? How do we say yes to something or no to something and then impart that to someone? Like, how does that practically happen? It seems like there's a lot of opposition to that.
I'm going to recuse myself. I lost the people. Schizophrenic.
Yeah, sure. Keep the question to me. I go away tomorrow. That's a great question. I don't know how to answer it other than to simply tell you about our experience at St. Joe's. Okay. At St. Joe's, our student body is three quarters Catholic. Okay? So we have one in four walking in our school that are not Catholic. So obviously the same with their families. When the families come in for an interview, I sit down with them and I tell them, you know, we make a proposal about life here. And it's a Catholic proposal. If you have a problem with that, this is not the school for you. Okay? And what I encourage them to do, so what I'm telling those families is, we're going to present truth. All right? We're going to present truth at the Catholic, let's just say truth. And I've had no families walk away from that. I've had no families come in to me and ask why their kids are being taught certain things about sexual ethics or so forth in theology classes. But what I have seen is I have seen kids embrace those truths and be attracted to the lived experience at the school and go home and tell their families that they want to go to Mass. There's a girl who, when she was in eighth grade, told her mother, I don't want to go to the Lutheran church anymore. I want to go to Mass. That mother told me 3 days ago that they're going to become Catholic. Right? This happens every year at my school. There will be four this year that will become Catholic. We've had whole families become Catholic. And it's partly because of the teaching. It is, I think, mainly because we do make an unashamed, unapologetic presentation. And I say we, I mean there are particular teachers that are exceptionally good at this. And then we stay with the kids, we accompany them. So it's one little piece at a time, you know, where you can. So I think I'm not afraid of having non-Catholic kids in the school. I'm not afraid of having non-Catholic families. I'm not afraid of having non-Christian families in the school. We don't treat them like second-class citizens. We don't change what we teach because they're there. We're simply there embracing their humanity and teaching what we understand to be true. That's the only way I know how to. Yeah, I think the problem is, right, when in the name of tolerance, truth no longer exists, right? There's no common good at that point. I don't know where to begin there, okay? Other than just simply individuals who work there, who hold that. I don't have a global solution for that, but I think there's a particular.
Hello, my name is Jeff Pressburg. I have a not so much a softball question, but not as difficult as that last one, I don't think. interesting things about recognizing the unity of desire, and not just recognizing, but trying to have the disposition to see it, and that carries you through the day as an educator. And also just this idea of helping the students recognize their own desire for eternity. And those are beautiful, lofty things. But how do we integrate in the day-to-day, into the curriculum, this idea and practice of leisure, this experience? And perhaps it's not educating us, how do we allow it to happen? So that there can be authentic personal experiences of the eternity, which is key to keeping the journey alive. Thank you.
I think it's easier to do it at university, maybe. I don't know. I would like to throw out the advanced placement courses out of my school, frankly. I got one applause for that. But we're slaves to those things. Now, I don't know if we have enough capital, educational capital in the community to be able to do it without the school going under. But I think that's a big problem, is that we submit ourselves to standards that make us rush to nowhere. And, the teachers who are artists in the classroom, they know how to do that. My best teachers don't assign a ton of homework. They might assign two or three essay questions twice a week, but they expect to read. They're Socratic in their method. Just a couple papers, and they make the biggest influence on the kids. It's changing this mentality that I've got to get it all in. And that's my teachers aren't clay, and they're people, and so they have to be moved to want to do that. I had to figure out totally how to do that.
I think you made reference to the notion of leisure, and I couldn't help but think of the great text by Joseph Heber, Leisure, Basis of Culture. I think Keith's point that it's probably easy to happen at the university, but there are great pressures.